Good morning, people of God. Welcome to worship. Thank you for sharing the gift of your presence today as we worship, whether you're joining us here in person or online. A couple of items just to remind you of as we begin today. Vacation Bible School is later this month. It's June, and June 24th to 28th are the dates. So it's time for participants to get registered and volunteers as well. If you haven't already done so, please do that. And the VBS donation wall is up, and it's in the community center just across from the welcome desk as you head out of the community center in those central doors. So if you have a chance to check out the donation wall for VBS, we'd appreciate that if you can help with supplies. Check it out after worship today if you haven't already. Donations are due by June 9th, next Sunday. And if you have any questions, check with Stephanie or Kat, please. Hopefully you received an email from council on Thursday a week ago about plans for the coming fiscal year. Please give that your prayerful discernment and attention if you haven't already, and let us know, let the office know, let us know if you did not receive an email from council a week ago Thursday or Friday. It got out to the whole congregation between Thursday and Friday a week ago. Council member and chair of Congregational Wellness, Debbie Mitchum, is here to share some announcements with us this morning. There's Debbie, there you are. Thanks. I usually see you back there. Yeah.
No, I can't sing today. I'm lucky I can speak. I've got this crud going on. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
So, yes, as Pastor Jay said, the email was sent out, not this past Thursday, but the week before. And if you have had a chance to look at it, you'll see that council's worked very hard preparing this mission and ministry plan for you, but you may have questions about it. We had some people this morning for a coffee with council, and we're going to have another one of those next week, June the 9th. And then we will vote on the 23rd on our mission and ministry plan. We've already had a really great response from some people who have agreed to give more for the rest of the calendar year, which may affect our numbers when we actually go to vote. If that's something you would like to do, you need to let Dan know by June the 15th. Otherwise, if you have questions, we're going to be available next week to talk about it. We'll vote on the 23rd. And thank you so much for your generous participation in this church. And on a personal note, I am going off council at the end of the month. And I want to thank you all, because as Chair of Congregational Wellness, we have restarted post-COVID some very important ministries in this church, and they've gone very, very well because of your participation, and I greatly appreciate it. So thank you all from the bottom of my heart, because I've realized how passionate I am about us taking care of each other in this church. So thank you again, and sign the care cards.
Thank you, Debbie. Last thing, turn to page 6 of your bulletin and look at our list of graduates. There are high school graduates listed, one college graduate. I do have two others to add, one high school graduate to add and one college graduate to add, and it was my omission because I wrote it down when someone spoke to me, and I lost the note shortly thereafter before I got it translated to Vicki. Just to add and make you aware of, and we'll print these in some way in the coming week. But Katie Hasley Brown is a high school graduate, and Sean Brown is a college graduate, both related to Ned. And just want to hold them in our prayers as well as the list you have before you. And Kat and Stephanie, come on up and share our blessing and recognition of graduates, please.
Where's Carolina? Carolina, come on up. Carolina is one of our rock star young people. She's very committed to the community, and we love seeing all the stuff she works on. But I'm going to let her introduce herself and tell you what she's got planned.
Hello, my name is Carolina Lazaretta da Silva. We joined First Lutheran in 2019. My mom, my dad, and my brother are back there. I am a graduate of Page High School. I'm graduating from the IB Diploma program, and I am going to Virginia Tech for neuroscience.
I want you to tell me about all the cords.
So my first one, this pink one, is for recognition of a lady of unmatched excellence. So I do work around the school for women and for young girls who might be going through difficult issues such as teen pregnancy or homelessness. My blue one is for academic excellence in the International Baccalaureate Diploma group. So this is for that diploma. And my green one is the one that I'm most proud of. It's for over 200 hours of community service.
Most excellent. We have a gift for you. There's lots of fun stuff in there, as well as things that will be useful to you when you start your college career. And I have a prayer. Let us pray. May God bless you with discomfort at easy answers, half-truths, and superficial relationships, so that you may live deep within your heart. May God bless you with anger at injustice, oppression, and exploitation of people, so that you may work for justice, freedom, and peace. May God bless you with tears to shed for those who suffer pain, rejection, hunger, and war, so that you may reach out your hand to comfort them and to turn their pain into joy. And may God bless you with enough foolishness to believe that you can make a difference in the world, so that you can do what others claim cannot be done, to bring justice and kindness to all our children and people. Amen.
Stand as you are able for the confession and forgiveness. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who writes the law on our hearts, who draws all people together through Jesus. Amen. Held in God's mercy, let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Holy God, we confess that we are caught in snares of sin and cannot break free. We hoard resources while our neighbors are hungry and cold. We speak when we should keep silent. We go silent when the time has come to speak. We keep score in our hearts. We let hurts grow into hatred. For all these things and for sins only you know, forgive us, Lord. Amen. Welcome here, for here is a flood of grace. Out of love for the whole world, God draws near to us, breaks every snare of sin, washes away our wrongs, and restores the promise of life. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share God's peace with one another. God's peace. Peace be with you. Thanks. Peace be with us.
Beautiful. Thank you.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord. Let us pray. O God, our sovereign shepherd, you anointed both David and Jesus as mighty leaders of your people, but also as humble servants of all. Help us to be attentive to your word, that we may accept your reign over us and serve you by being humble servants of your whole creation. Amen. Please be seated. And invite Stephanie up, any children present, to share the children's message today. Don't see anybody. You want to give us a quick?
Sure.
Thanks.
Good morning. So in life, we have rules. But rules are also made to sometimes be broken. Now, in life, there's also consequences to if you break those rules. But some rules are just plain silly. Did you know that in one state, you cannot wear a fake mustache to church? So, anybody with a fake mustache on, shame on you. In North Carolina, you cannot use an elephant to help you plow your garden. Don't know about you, but I don't have any pet elephants just hanging around. You also can't keep an alligator in a bathtub. But those are real rules that states have made. They're silly. But there's one rule that's not so silly, but it's also the one that might be the hardest to follow through. And that's the rule that Jesus gave us, which was to love everyone. Now, I'll admit, like, it's very difficult for me to love somebody when they're being mean to me. But that's what Jesus does. He loved everybody, his followers, his believers, his non-believers. It doesn't matter who it was. Jesus said, I love you. And that's the one thing that he needs us to remember is that we need to love everybody just like he loved everybody. Love your neighbor as yourself. Isn't that the golden rule? So Pastor Michael and I, we've known each other for many, many, many years. And there's this one sentence that we use, and many other people know it too. But God loves you, and so do I. And yes, it is very hard sometimes to do that and so do I part. But God loves you, and so do I. Let's pray. Hey God, thank you so much for teaching us what love is. Thank you for sending us Jesus who loves us, even if we break the rules sometimes. We are always there to love our neighbors because you are always there as you love us. We love you. We love Jesus. God loves you, and so do I. Amen.
Thank you. reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 5, verses 12 through 15. Observe the Sabbath day and keep it holy, as the Lord your God commanded you. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. You shall not do any work, you or your son or your daughter, or your male or female slave, or your ox or your donkey, or any of your livestock, or the immigrants in your towns, so that your male and female slave may rest as well as you. Remember that you were a slave in the land of Egypt, and the Lord your God brought you out from there with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm. Therefore, the Lord your God commanded you to keep the Sabbath day. Here ends the reading. Please stand as you are able for the gospel acclamation.
The gospel according to Mark, the second chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. One Sabbath, Jesus and his disciples were passing through some fields of wheat while walking from one town to another. Along the way, they plucked some of the heads of grain. Some Pharisees caught them in the act and took it up with them. Look at your followers. Why are they acting against the Sabbath law? Jesus replied, have you never read the story about what David did when he and his companions were hungry and in need of food? How he entered the holy house of God during the reign of Abiathar as high priest, and how they ate the bread of the presence, which it is not lawful for anyone but the priest to eat. And then he gave some to his companions. You see, the Sabbath was made for humankind, not humankind for the Sabbath. The good news of God for all people. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated. I've got to share with you, Stephanie mentioned the same thing at the contemporary service about that mantra that we live by, and it comes out of Vita Christo and tech and some of those things where God loves you and so do I, but I also have heard it and used it another way, and that is, God loves you and I'm trying, okay? And I think on certain days that's just as valid, right? God loves you and I'm trying. But keep that in mind on those days when it isn't quite the same as the easy to love days. Well, here we are early in Mark's gospel. This is only the second chapter of 16 chapters, and we see Jesus getting into conflict with some of the leaders of his day, which we know ultimately led to his execution. In this story, Jesus makes an important point about how we use rules and laws, and that really upsets some of these leaders. Go forward. 1400 plus years, during the Reformation period of Martin Luther and the other reformers, religious leaders and scholars loved to debate God's opinion about rules and laws. Those of religion and those of the civil world as well, the civic world. Luther wrote about three uses of the law, and he wrote a lot about the third use of the law in some documents that we learn about in seminary when we are there for becoming a pastor. Luther said the three uses of the law are this. Number one, to help curb social chaos and maintain order in society. Good use. Number two, to point out our own sin and imperfection so we realize and see our need for God's grace and God's forgiveness in our lives. And three, to help people of faith, you and me, those who are followers, believers, to live a holy life, use the law and the rules as guides, trying to be more Christ-like every day. Now, those seem very reasonable attributes of the law, I would say, but But notice what's missing. There is something missing. Notice there is no use of laws and rules in this list that make certain people superior and other people inferior. There's no use of rules or laws to create insiders and outsiders in society or anywhere else. And there's no mention of using rules and laws to judge some people and say they are not worthy of God's grace, but they or we are. Luther didn't have that in his list, and it's apparent that Jesus didn't have that as his intention either in understanding, sharing, and interpreting the law. Why is that? Perhaps rules and laws are different than what we understand to be the things that hold us back or put us in place. Perhaps there is a more deeper meaning and beauty to laws and rules as far as God is concerned. And perhaps rules and laws are intended to be another expression in our lives of God's love. I know I didn't see it that way as a child growing up when mom and dad or school or whatever had rules that I didn't want to pay attention to. But in this case, it looks like that love is one way how God takes care of the world and the human family. So love, God's perfect total gift of grace, complete and total love, is supposed to be the source behind all the rules and laws, whether it's civil law or religious rules and commands. They're meant to be utilized as a sheer gift from God. And perhaps, as we contemplate that, we can see that God's supreme law and ultimate law of love is to be the one guiding rule that really dictates how we apply and interpret all the other laws and rules. That seemed to be what Jesus was getting at. That seemed to be where Luther was coming from. But we humans forget love when it comes to laws and rules, don't we? We use them to exercise power. We use them to have control over other people. We use them to judge people. We use them to feel better than others. In our reading, it was the same for the Sabbath laws that Jesus and his followers are accused of breaking that day as they walk through grain fields plucking grain to eat. The Sabbath laws for God's people in Jesus' day were not first and foremost meant to please God. That is, based on some reward and punishment system. That was never the case. And it was rather, as the text from Exodus that we read says, these laws are intended to help people. That's the point Jesus makes in his debate with the Pharisees that day. Even when the Sabbath laws were given to God's people in the Hebrew scriptures, as we read, it says the Sabbath exists for the good of everyone, even slaves and servants. Oh, and sons and daughters, by the way. Because if you're rich and powerful and you want to take a day off, that's all well and good because rich and powerful people could do that whenever they wanted. However, we tend to forget that when we have that kind of wealth and power, we demand others to still work for us and serve us. And the Sabbath law intentionally mentions slaves and servants and sons and daughters. Everyone is treated as equals under the Sabbath law, and God makes a point of mentioning slaves and servants as equal to everyone else in the workplace. Now that is sheer brilliance as well as a wow moment for all of us. When Jesus is questioned about why his disciples were doing work by plucking grain on the Sabbath to have something to eat, he reminds them of a time when King David was hungry. He ate the bread of the presence in the temple, and in David's day, it was only supposed to be eaten by the priest for religious ritual. Kind of like someone knocking on the door here at church and saying, can I, on a Wednesday, and saying, can I eat all your communion bread and wafers? Please, I'm hungry. And when something like that happens, we would say, ooh, that's not what that's for. That's not the way it's supposed to work. Jesus says God's love for a hungry person outweighs the rules about religious worship rituals. He says a person's hunger is more important to God than the proper observance of religious rituals. Love for the human family is what matters most. I want to give you a scenario from my own life to help you think about how we use and understand, interpret, and apply rules and laws. Think about a stop sign. How many of you think a stop sign is a good idea? Well, of course it is, right? It's a law that we use most every day, and probably most of us used on our way here today. Stop signs protect us and keep us safe. They are necessary and helpful. A very good and important law, I would say. Well, one day when I was 19 years old, I was leaving my parents' house. I came to the end of the street, which emptied into a more major roadway that had separate traffic in each direction with a grass and tree median in between. And I came to the stop sign. I stopped and I looked left. And when I looked left, I couldn't see a thing if anything was on the road coming. I couldn't even see the road. And that was because there were too many trees too close to the road that had grown so thick and so wide that there was no way from the stop sign you could see oncoming traffic. So I started inching forward very slowly. I kept my foot on the brake while I was continuing to move slowly forward, and I was also trying to get a better view. When I was finally able to see the road and confirm that there was no oncoming traffic, I was at least 5 or 10 feet beyond the stop sign. Seeing it was safe, I took my foot off the brake and I turned. But the police officer who pulled me over about a minute later did not see me stop. He did not see me pause at the stop sign. What he saw was me easing out slowly beyond the sign, gradually into the lane of traffic. I got a ticket for failure to come to a complete stop, even though I knew that I had. Long story short, I went to the court. I went to court to explain what had happened. And I brought with me a witness who was going to say, and actually did get the chance to say, yes, he came to a complete stop. I also brought pictures of the intersection with the trees that go beyond the stop sign and beyond the view of sight from the stop sign. And I was also very lucky because the local judge knew that intersection well. He lived just down the road and went through that neighborhood on occasion. He knew also exactly where the police officer always sat to catch speeders and teenagers who weren't stopping at stop signs, right? And the judge said to me and to the police officer that day, among other things, turns out you were both right. I know that intersection, and I know you can't see oncoming traffic from that stop sign. I also know that based on where the police officer was sitting, there is no way, he said, you, to the police officer, could have seen this driver stop. You could only see him easing out into traffic beyond the stop sign because of all the trees that are blocking his view as well as your view. He said, they really need to trim those trees. The good news is here that that judge understood his role in interpreting the real purpose of the law and the rules to keep people safe and to make life better for everyone. He knew that both the police officer and I were acting in the best interest of the public and others' safety. We had both done the right thing, the thing that was most helpful to others. And he knew it wasn't about the letter of the law, but more about the spirit of the law or the intent of the law. It was about the purpose of the law being fulfilled in order to protect people. He thanked us both for doing the right thing. He dismissed the case, thankfully, and rescinded the traffic violation. There's an instance where we know what the letter of the law says, and we know there are cases where that isn't necessarily the most loving thing for anyone to do. The bulletin cover on your bulletin is a quote from John Pavlovitz. He says that Jesus is far more relational than theological. When we talk about rules and laws and God's commands, we get really in our heads and try to, whether it's argue about or debate or be meticulous about interpreting these rules and laws and commands from God and apply them to others as well as society. And that's a lot of good headwork that we need to do. But Jesus always, in view of the law, took the relational aspect equally as important or even more important. One of Pavlovitz's other notable quotes from his book says, "Your theology is only valid to the degree that your life is loving." What you believe about God is only valid to the degree that you love and try to love like God. When Jesus says that the Sabbath was made for people and not people for the Sabbath, he is saying that God in giving these laws is about love much more so than anything else, more than rules, and that God's ultimate rule is, in fact, love. When it comes to living our lives day in and day out, trying to be a follower of Jesus, we all have choices to make. And one of those choices in life is going to be about using rules and laws to compare ourselves to others, to see who's better and who's worse, to rank ourselves, to prove who's right or wrong, and to decide who's in and who's out. And that's a life based entirely on rules, where people and relationships come a distant second place. Or, like the judge who handled my traffic case, is life more about making sure that the intent of the laws and the rules and the commands are honored? Because life is more about relating to one another in the most loving way possible. It's pretty clear what Jesus would want us to conclude. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand and join with me for the Apostles' Creed as we profess our faith together. Together we say, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. I invite you to be seated or to kneel for the prayers. We gather in the presence of God, Creator, Lord, and Companion, to pray for our neighbors, ourselves, and the world. Good and gracious God, we thank you for rules and laws that keep order, that protect human rights, and that strive to make life better for everyone. Help us, and especially help those in leadership, to refrain from using laws to exclude, to demean, to judge, or to exercise power over others unfairly. Thank you for reminding us that we are all equals under your rule, and that ultimately, rules, laws, and commands exist to exhibit your love for the whole human family. Lord, teach us to be the most loving people we can possibly be. God of grace, lead us in love. O God, our parent, you created the whole human family in your image, and you blessed us with a diversity of personalities, gifts, ideas, and passions. During this month of global recognition and thanksgiving for our LGBTQ plus siblings, we lament the church's history of prejudice and intolerance. We thank you for opening our hearts and our eyes to a fuller vision of your grace through the life and ministry of Jesus Christ. May your Spirit continue to open our minds to see the humanity of others as we live and work together for equality, for justice, and for reconciliation in this one beautiful human family. God of grace, lead us in love. We thank you for calling us together in this time and place, in community, as we tend to the mission and ministry of Jesus through First Lutheran Church. We pray for our congregation, our council, and our staff. Guide us by your life-giving Holy Spirit in all the actions we take and all the decisions we make together. God of grace, lead us in love. We pray for all high school and college graduates, including those among us here at First Lutheran. We lift up and pray for Daniel, Jason, Mason, Jameson, Alexis, Carolina, Julian, George, Ryan, Grant, Hannah, RJ, Matthew, Katie. We pray for Megan, Lynn, and Sean. We celebrate this milestone with them and with their families. May your Spirit guide them as they continue to discern and discover all you have in store for them. God of grace, renew us, lead us in love. Gracious God, as we gather here, we call to mind and heart those we wish to pray for. We thank you for loved ones who have recently died. We thank you for their lives of faith and witness. We pray for those families who are grieving and loved ones who are grieving as we give thanks for David Palmer, Paralee Payne, and Elizabeth Davidson. May we continue to offer comfort and a reminder of your eternal promises. We also lift up others who need comfort, care, and a measure of healing. And so we pray for Judy, Rusty, Anne, Madeline, Joanne, Jim, Ray, Tom, Kay, Martha, Zoe, Alan, and Margot. There are others that are on our hearts and minds this day, O God. We take a moment to name them before you now, either silently or out loud. May we continue to be your source of companionship for those who need healing and comfort in their lives. God of grace, lead us in your love. All these things we pray, O God, through the power of the Spirit and the love of Jesus Christ. Amen. You may be seated. As the offering is being received, take a moment, please, to make sure you pass and fill out the fellowship books, the black fellowship books on each row, if you haven't already done that. If you are not in touch with us and we don't have your contact information, please give us a phone number and an email so someone can be in touch. Thank you.
Oh, lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. God of our weary years, our silent tears, you have brought us this far along the way. In times of bitterness, you didn't abandon us, but you guided us into the path of love and light. In every age, you sent prophets to make known your loving will for all humanity. The cry of the poor has become your own cry. Our hunger and thirst for justice is your own desire. You sent your chosen servant to preach good news to the afflicted, to break bread with the outcast and despised, and to ransom those in bondage to prejudice and sin. And then in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." We ask you also, O God, to send your Holy Spirit, our advocate, to fill the hearts of all who share this bread and cup with courage and wisdom to pursue love and justice in all the world. Join our prayers and praise with your prophets and martyrs of every age, that rejoicing in the hope of the resurrection, we might live in the freedom and hope of your Son. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, now and forever. Amen. Now, Lord Jesus, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. This is the feast of God for the people of God. All are welcome at God's table. Communion assistants may come forward at this time.
Oh,
body of Christ. Amen for you.
Thank you.
Please rise as you are able. May the risen presence of our Lord Jesus Christ and the life-giving love of Almighty God, our Creator, strengthen you and keep you in God's grace, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your liberating love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Now receive this blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine on you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. and now go with Christ and go as Christ to serve God's world.
Thanks be to God.